It usually stays pretty good, unless I... I have to figure out my guitar to play some metal. We need to do that. Mm-hmm. I haven't had time to look at it.
Yep.
What's praise? We'll do like nothing can separate into praise.
Nothing can separate.
I don't hate that.
That's a Jesus Culture song. I don't know if he knows that. Beep, beep.
Thumbs up. Let's go.
Oh. Good morning, Pursuits. Morning. Good morning. Welcome. Please stand and worship our Lord.
Just for Tried to run, but still you came, and you stepped into the dark, 'cause that's just the kind of God you are. When heaven seems beyond my reach, you still see eternity in me. You're turning ashes into art, 'cause that's just the kind of God you are. It's in the empty tomb, it's on the rugged cross, your death-defying love is written in your scars. You'll never quit on me, you'll always hold my heart, 'cause that's the kind of God. Told me I could start again. All of the hurt is dead and gone. Now we're your daughters and your sons. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. We once were lost, but now we're found. Forever you'll hold us in your arms, 'cause that's just the kind of God. Defying love is written in your scars. You'll never quit on me, you'll always hold my heart, 'cause that's the kind of God you are. Holy, 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 high and set apart. Slept into the dark, 'cause that's just the kind of God you are.
You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome once again to Pursuit. You made it to the new meeting time, and congratulations. Well, if you can think of a better day of the week than this one, I challenge you, let me know. But today we get to worship God, and that's why we've gathered together to be here. Well, you might notice in these bright lights a little reddish glow on my face. That's because I was at the beach with my family, and Brad and Maddie, my son Brad and Maddie, are visiting from Colorado, so we had a nice beach day yesterday. Thus the glow. So glad that they're here with us this weekend. Well, today is a historic day. It's the first day in 25 years that we have met at a time other than 10:30 a.m. And it's also historic because we are beginning our time of discipleship in the church. Some people would think of it as adult Sunday school, but we call it My Next Steps Discipleship. And so what we've done is we made some adjustments to our schedule in order to make some time for that. It'll be after our service each week. And so we will be making a few adjustments in the service to shorten things up, and then by about 11:15 or 11:20 each week, we'll go into probably 45 minutes of study time together. And what we're doing is we've charted a course for everyone, for everyone's growth. Whether you're a brand new Christian or a mature Christian, we have a next step for you. And so my hope is that everyone that is at Pursuit will be a part of this this My Next Steps. And our goal is that you'll find your next step in terms of your growth as we meet together. Well, at Pursuit, we have the three big B's. That is belong, believe, and become. We want everyone to find a place of belonging. We want to help you in your faith to believe better and stronger, and also to become what God is calling you to become, and that is like His Son, Jesus Christ. And so that's what we're about. Well, each week we also like to read from our doctrinal statement. And so I asked Jeffrey to come and read from the 1689 London Baptist Confession.
Good morning, everyone. This comes from chapter 16 of Good Works, and let's see this from the point of view that this is God's perspective, and He is our designer. Good works are obedience to God's word. The only good works are works commanded by God in the Bible. They do not include works that are not commanded by the Bible, such as those done by humans out of blind zeal or with the appearance of good intentions. Micah 6:8. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. And 1 John 5:1-4. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. By this we know that we love the children of God, that we love God and obey His commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith.
Morning. So we also transitioned a little bit, and instead of Maishim coming up every single week for prayer, we're going to have different members from the congregation come up on a weekly basis. So this is our time for prayer. And it also happens to be that today, if you celebrate such a day, today is Grandparents Day. So I want to congratulate the grandparents, especially future grandparents, Pastor Dave and Janine, who have the privilege of having the three Colorado Bakers here in house, because baby's on board, due in a couple of months. So it's great to see them here. But in a similar fashion, as we honor our grandparents in our family relationships, we should also honor and hold up our elders, our deacons, and our leaders in the church. And as we go through this time of transition, as Pastor Dave said, the first time in 25 years that we're changing our start time, we're adding in the My Next Steps discipleship afterwards, be praying for, and let's pray for our leadership here at the church, that we continue to do always what God has us to do, that we look at the three B's of belonging, believing, and becoming, and have that be our focus, our mission, and our vision. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you and praise you for our grandparents. We thank you for all the blessings that we've had, for the times that we've spent with our grandparents, and for those that will be grandparents. As well, Father, we thank you for our elders, our deacons, our leaders in the church. We pray, Father, that you would guide them all, that they may always seek to do your will and to glorify you and to spread your kingdom and your love. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
And before I invite the deacons to come and receive your tithes and offerings, I want to make another announcement to the church, and that is Tony and I have had our eye on Vic Rosenbaum for a while now to become a next elder, and so he is. We've asked Vic to be an elder, and he has accepted this week, and so. Yep. So some of the main qualifications of an elder are that a person has good reputation, a person is able to teach, and so Vic and I have been going through theology for the last 3 or 4 years now, and he's been leading his home group and teaching the Word of God, and also that he's hospitable and known to the congregation as someone who serves. And so Vic has been serving as the chairman of the deacons for some time now. And so we're excited for the role and ministry that God has called Vic to. And in a couple weeks' time, we will ask you to affirm Vic as being the next elder here at Pursuit. And so, yes. Well, now I invite the deacons to come and receive your tithes and offerings. Well, the children can be dismissed to their class. Well, I have a question for you. Have you ever thought about what is the mission of my life? Now, most of us don't actually think in those terms on a regular basis, but we're pretty much thinking, well, what's the mission of today? And that's usually just to get through it. But the fact is that God does have a bigger plan for you than survival and or success or the other things that we sort of fill in the blank into that question. So people in the military know that they know about mission objectives. And when you enter the military, you are trained, and then when you're deployed, you have mission objectives each time that you have a deployment. And the fact is that as a believer, we also have mission objectives, and God has called us to follow him and to fulfill those objectives. Now, the 12 disciples, when they followed Jesus, sometimes were a little bit lost as to what their mission in life was about in following Jesus. They kept wondering, where are we going, or what are we doing, or when is Jesus going to establish his kingdom here on the earth? And these are the sorts of questions that they would ask of Jesus. But as we know, looking back on them and their life, they neither had the ability to understand or the ability to believe it until Jesus was crucified and he rose from the dead and he appeared to them in rooms and in other odd places over 50 days. And finally, Jesus gave the Holy Spirit to them so they could finally understand what their mission in life was. But the people that we see today in our passage as we go through, read it in the book of Acts, they understood that they were on a mission, and that what we're going to see is that the basic mission objectives that they were following as we read through our passage today. So last week I said that this week would be our last week in the book of Acts, and actually it's going to be next week. And then what we'll do is start in the book of James on September 22nd, and in that Sunday that's between then and now, Sergiu Matai, one of our missionaries of Pursuit, will come and give us our message next week. Now, our passage today is from Acts 18, chapter 18, and it starts like this. It says, "After this, Paul stayed many days longer and then took leave of the brothers to set sail for Syria." And so we have to ask, well, after what? And so let me give a little bit of review here. Okay, so Paul had come to Corinth, the city of Corinth, and he'd come alone. And he was sort of chased across Achaia, which is modern-day Greece, and he preached Christ in the synagogue at Corinth and had a great effect on the people that were there. Many people believed, both Gentiles and Jews, and it was so effective that even the leader of the synagogue, a man named Crispus, and his whole family came to believe. So they had to move their base of operation from the synagogue in Corinth to the house next door, which was one of the believers, and because the Jews began to oppose them. And during this time, it seems that Paul himself, the great apostle, fearless Paul, needed some encouragement from the Lord, because the Lord, it says, came to him in a vision. So we gather that Paul was afraid. Being in a new place, being alone, the opposition was beginning to mount against them. Paul was afraid of being beaten again, like he was earlier, even in Philippi. And so the Lord came to him in the night and said, and the Lord said to Paul one night in a vision, "Do not be afraid, but go on speaking and do not be silent, for I am with you, and no one will attack you to harm you. For I have many in this city who are my people." So even the Apostle Paul could be scared and discouraged. And strangely enough, that encourages us. And so in our passage today, it's Acts 18, starting at verse 18. "After this, Paul stayed many days longer, and when he took leave of the brothers, he set sail for Syria, and with him was Priscilla and Aquila. At Cenchrea, he had his hair cut, for he was under a vow. And they came to Ephesus, and he left them there, but he himself went into the synagogue, and he reasoned with the Jews. And when they asked him to stay for a longer period, he declined. But on taking leave of them, he said, 'I will return to you if God wills.' And he set sail from Ephesus. And when he had landed in Caesarea, he went up, and he greeted the church, and Then he went down to Antioch. And after spending some time there, he departed and went from one place to the next through the region of Galatia and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. Now a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus, and he was an eloquent man, competent in the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in spirit, he spoke and taught accurately the things concerning Jesus, though he knew only the baptism of John. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue, but when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. And he went, and he wished to cross to Achaia. The brothers encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. And when he arrived, he greatly helped those who, through grace, had believed. For he powerfully refuted the Jews in public, showing by the scriptures that the Christ was Jesus. So in this passage, we see people that have a clear vision or a clear mission that they are working together. So they have this clear mission that they're working together. And so what we see in this passage, we see worship. We see fellowship. We see discipleship. We see evangelism. And we see teamwork. So Jesus, to the disciples, explained the mission to his disciples in different ways. And this is one of them. And we find that in Matthew 28, 18. So before Jesus ascended back to heaven after his resurrection, he came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." And so there is this command that Jesus gave, and he said to go to all of the nations with the gospel and also to make disciples. So what Jesus wants is believers that are disciples. So the earliest name for believers was, before they were even called Christians, was disciples. That's how they were known. But every believer is meant to be a disciple. And so let's talk about what is a disciple. First of all, a disciple is a follower of Jesus. A follower of Jesus is someone who learns to live like Jesus lived. Jesus modeled what it was like to be in communion with God. And he prayed to God his Father. So he prayed and followed the Father's will in everything. So Jesus also loved people. And the primary need of people is, of course, that they believe in Jesus so that they can be restored to a relationship with God through Jesus. And so, as we just sang in the song, in John 14, Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And so, first of all, an attribute of a disciple is, first of all, that they are saved, that they know the gospel, and they've been reconciled to God through Jesus, and they're saved by faith. Secondly, is a disciple is someone who learns or is taught all that Jesus commanded them. And therefore, in this verse is to evangelize and disciple other people. If we're going to follow Jesus, we are going to share the gospel and also be discipled ourselves and disciple others. So Jesus calls people to the greatest type of human life that we have. So a life where we get to become like Jesus. Imagine that. We are called to become like Jesus. And so from the very creation, God said, "Let us make man in our image," but we know that that image has become marred through sin. But now what God is doing in Christ is bringing us back and restoring us and remaking that image so that we become like Christ. So God calls a disciple to love God as Jesus did. That was a mark of Jesus. If we're going to follow him, we're going to learn how to love God. So the people that Jesus most commended in the Bible were those people that loved God the best. So one day, a woman who was a sinner came into a room where Jesus was, and she cried over her sin, and the Bible says that her tears fell on Jesus' feet, and she bowed down and she used her hair to wipe off Jesus' feet. So that must have been tremendously touching to be in that room and to see that. But Jesus commended her for her love to a Pharisee that did nothing for Jesus. He didn't offer him water to wash his feet or anything like that. And so Jesus says this in Luke chapter 7. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little. And so a mark of a disciple is also that we love God. So God calls us to be like Jesus also in that we care for other people as Jesus did. So it is God's will that we work in our various professions in our life or vocations. So some are called to be school teachers, and some are auto mechanics, and doctors and administrators and financial people and all these things. And so in these vocations, we work out the will of God in and through those vocations that he called us to. So most of us, like Paul, are not called to go to foreign countries and break hard ground. But we also need to carry this mentality. We need to carry this mentality that our life is a mission, okay? And God calls you to fulfill it. God has work for you to do. So as a church, so Maestrum in the previous weeks has been leading us to pray through what we call this Francis acronym, friends, relatives, acquaintances, neighbors, co-workers, enemies, and strangers, Francis. And so these people are in all of our lives, and that is our mission field. These people are our mission field. And so we don't have to go to Botswana, for example. There's probably more Christians there than there are here anyway. But we do need foreign missions. Don't get me wrong there. We need foreign missions. There's people that have never heard, the cultures and people groups that have never had a clear representation of Christ. So it's just that God doesn't have to call you personally to a foreign mission field in order to have a mission. We all do. So Emmy here, he drives his truck around, his service truck around town, and he regularly tries to engage people about their faith in Christ. And so you might have thought that when you put your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, that all you were doing was asking God to forgive you from your sin. Well, that is true, but God seems to be saying, I am forgiving you from your sins, but I'm also calling you to do much more than that. I'm calling you to be transformed into the image of my Son and to be his disciple. And so we signed up for a little bit, and God gives us, as he always does, so much more. Well, in any vocation, a person needs a vision of what you are to become. So if you're a new student at UCF, you have an eye on a degree, and you're willing to sign up for that 130 credit hours or whatever it is in order to achieve that degree. You have a vision of what you can be by that course of study. So we also need to exert a lot of hard work and effort and also to gain knowledge and gain skill along the way. All of these things are needed, and they're also true in our Christian life. God calls us to hard work and to gaining knowledge and to gaining skills. And so if we're gonna fulfill our mission, we need to pursue all of those things. So let's drill into our passage a little bit. So let's talk about what we see in this passage. The first thing that I mentioned was worship. And if you're astute, you might wonder where the worship was in this text. And it's right here in verse 18. It says, after this, Paul stayed many days longer, and he took leave of the brothers and set sail for Syria. With him was Priscilla and Aquila. And at Cenchrea, he had his hair cut, for he was under a vow. That's the worship. Didn't see it? I'll explain it. So it's believed that what Paul was doing is he was participating in what's called the vow of the Nazarite. And this is described in the Old Testament in the book of Deuteronomy. So Numbers 6, verse 2. God says to Moses, speak to the people of Israel and say to them, whenever a man or a woman makes a special vow, the vow of a Nazarite, to separate himself to the Lord, he shall separate himself from wine and strong drink. In all the days of his separation, he shall eat nothing that is produced by the grapevine. And it goes on to say, verse 5, in all the days of his vow of separation, no razor shall touch his head until the time has completed for which he separates himself to the Lord. He shall be holy. He shall let the locks of his hair, of his head grow long. And the Nazarite shall shave his consecrated head at the entrance of the tent of the meeting and shall take the hair from his consecrated head and put it on the fire that is under the sacrifice of the peace offering. And so some strange sounding things there, but this was a ritual of separation, of a vow that a person voluntarily took to say, Lord, I want to be holy to you. I want to separate myself for this time period. And so God prescribed some ways that we could worship him. So Paul was participating in this voluntary act of worship. And maybe it was that Paul, when he was in Corinth and he was down and he was depressed and he was afraid, that perhaps that's when he made a vow to the Lord. We don't know. But perhaps he also just wanted to thank God for protecting him in Corinth. And so he took this vow and said, I'm gonna voluntarily do this vow of the Nazarite. I'm gonna separate myself. I'm gonna let my hair grow out. And by the time he went to he left Corinth, it says that he went and he had his hair cut at Cenchrea. So when he had landed at Caesarea, it says that he went up and he greeted the church, and then he went down to Antioch. And so the fact that it says he went up, it's very slight language for us, but the fact that he went up, it meant to Jerusalem. That's how they spoke. You'd go up to Jerusalem because it was a higher elevation, like you would go up to Denver, where Brad and Maddie live. And then it says he came down to Antioch. So we believe he went to Jerusalem, and the fact that he went there, he was carrying his cut hair to complete the ritual of worship at the temple in Jerusalem. And so it was a special act of devotion for Paul to worship in a God, worship God in a way that was voluntary and binding once he initiated that, because he had made a vow to God. And so we see the Apostle Paul, even in, he wants to worship God. And he also greeted the church that was in Jerusalem that James was pastoring. And so what this reminds us of is that despite all of our work in serving the Lord, we like to do work, but what a disciple is also a worshiper. A disciple is a worshiper. And when we worship, we are filling part of what we were made for. God made you to be a worshiper. To love and to worship God is really the highest part of our calling. And so in our My Next Step discipleship, we will include how to love and to worship God. Now, Jesus, in his example, he would steal away before sunrise, and he would commune with God, his Father. Now, I don't think we could say that Jesus worshiped God. That wouldn't be appropriate because Jesus is co-equal with God the Father and the Holy Spirit and the Trinity, but he communed with his Father and the Holy Spirit. And so we also as disciples need to take time to worship and just abide and be with God in worship. So often when I'm reading my Bible, I read a passage and I can be just overwhelmed with God's grace. And I pause and I bow my head, and often there might be a tear in my eye. And I just praise God and I thank God for his grace that we see in the Bible. And so I know that you do that as well and have those times. But we worship God in prayer. We worship God in our singing, in reading a psalm, or even fasting as a way that we can voluntarily say, Lord, I want to worship you. And God accepts our worship and our acts of devotion even when they are imperfect. God sees our heart, and disciples are called to be worshipers. So let's talk about fellowship. So we see again that Paul saw that fellowship was important too. In verse 22, and when he landed in Caesarea, he went up and he greeted the church, and then he went back down to Antioch and he greeted that church. He wanted to fellowship with them and just share stories about what God had been doing on his mission. It was also part of his mission to encourage other believers. And so he saw that in himself, of just his presence there, of being an encouragement. So I can say that to all of you. Thank you for being here. Your presence is an encouragement to everyone else. And we need to keep that going and remember that when you come to Pursuit, be ready to give, be ready to pray for somebody, offer a word of encouragement, just talk to someone else and say, how was your week? How can I pray for you? As part of that type of fellowship and encouragement. So with good Christian friends, most of the time when we call them or phone them and we get together over a meal or something, the conversation usually is something to the effect of what's the Lord doing in your life. Conversations will turn that direction. And that's one of the ways that we know that God has really changed us, that we want to talk about him to other Christians and other believers. That's an evidence of a changed heart. And so when we get together to fellowship, we like to hear about each other and how we're doing in our life struggles. We love to hear of other people coming into the Lord. We want to pray for one another. So a disciple is someone who fellowships with other Christians, and they know what they are doing is an encouragement to one another. And so a disciple fellowships. Let's talk about discipleship. So a disciple worships and a disciple fellowships, and also a disciple disciples. So we are called to be disciples, and we're also called to disciple. I mean, that means discipling someone else. So basically what that means is that we are imparting our lives to one another. And so now my dad was not a Christian, but he discipled me in auto mechanics. And he when I was 8 years old, he bought me what was called the Visible V8 engine model. Okay, and I built this model out of plastic, and I learned about all the pieces and how an engine could function and work because of that model. And so he also made me work on cars with him, even though I did not want to, many, many times. But the fact is, today I do all of my own auto mechanics because of that discipleship. And so in the Christian life, we disciple each other. And there are parts of the Christian life that other people are going to be more knowledgeable than we are, and more spiritual than we are too. And so we need to learn, be learning from one another. We are discipling one another. So in verse 24, It says, now a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus, and he was an eloquent man, competent in the scriptures. And he had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in spirit, he spoke and taught accurately the things concerning Jesus, though he knew only of the baptism of John. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. But when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. And so Apollos would have been this probably double doctorate kind of degree person compared to Priscilla and Aquila. And but the thing is, he listened to Priscilla. And so notice Priscilla is mentioned first in this passage. She's probably the primary one sharing with him. But he had some gaps in his knowledge of Christ, and it said he knew only the baptism of John. And so John's baptism preceded Jesus' earthly ministry, and his baptism that John the Baptist declared was a baptism of repentance, telling people basically to turn away from yourself and turn to God. That's what repentance means. Turning away from yourself and turning to God. But it's difficult to know where Apollos' gaps were. So he could preach Jesus as the Christ from the Old Testament, but maybe he had not heard of the resurrection of Jesus or even come to understand salvation by faith. But maybe it was only that he could not preach the gospel through the ordinance of Christian baptism. So he knew the baptism of John, but maybe he didn't know Christian baptism. And so he didn't know that how baptism is symbolic of new life in Christ and the resurrection life in Jesus and how it's shown in this physical act of descending into the water and being raised up into new life. Maybe that's what Apollos couldn't preach. We don't know. So I do want to say, by the way, we would like to have some baptisms in the weeks ahead. And so if you have not been baptized and want to know more about it, please talk to me. But Priscilla was able to disciple Apollos in explaining to him the way of God more accurately. So we also see that Paul and Apollos had a dual mission objective. And first was to evangelize people, and what that means, of course, is to share the gospel or good news with them so that they can turn in faith to Jesus and be saved. But secondly, a disciple, to disciple people or help them to grow. That was their second objective, and they always did that. And it appears that they had taken both objectives as absolutely important. So we see that Paul made strengthening the disciples a priority. Verse 23, and after spending some time back in Antioch, it says he departed and he went from one place to the next through the region of Galatia and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. So that was his first missionary journey, where he stopped in all those places and was beaten and run out of town and all of that we preached through recently. But he went back to those places, and it says he was strengthening all the disciples. That means he was encouraging them and discipling them. So without strong disciples, there will be no church. And if there's no church, there will be no continuing witness in whatever town or city that those churches were in. But not only that, God is glorified not just when we're saved, but when you grow. God is glorified when you grow, not just coming to salvation. So at the end of our lives, there will be a judgment, not of our sins, because they are already forgiven in Christ, but of our works. God will judge our works. And if they are of faith, we will receive a reward. If they're there just to boost our pride or put on a good show, then they will be burned up. And no reward will be given. It's amazing how 1689 repeats the same thing. I didn't even look at it. But 1 Corinthians 3:12. Now if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. And so we see that, but now we see Paul growing disciples and evangelizing in this passage in verse 19. And it says, they came to Ephesus, and he left them there, but he himself went to the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. And Apollos, in the same way, in verse 28, Apollos was able, once he went over to Achaia or Greece, in verse 28, it says, he powerfully refuted the Jews in public, showing by the scriptures that the Christ was Jesus. And so we see in Paul and Apollos' life that they're concerned about discipleship, but they're also concerned about evangelism. In this passage, we also see that Paul and Priscilla and Aquila and Apollos were working together in the gospel. There was teamwork. And so one of my dreams for this church is that we find out how to work together in the gospel. Working together. I mean, individually, we have our gospel assignments, right, with our families and relatives and acquaintances and all those Francis people. But I would like us as a church to be able to learn how to work together in the gospel. Not just as individuals as we go out to share our faith, but that we figure out how to work together to reach the community around us. And so my next steps discipleship is going to help us to think through how to work together in the gospel. So to me, this whole passage is about knowing our mission objectives and just continuing on to do them. That's what Paul and Apollos were doing. So we need the strength of the Lord to just keep going on, but we also need the strength from each other to continue doing what God has called us to do. Please pray with me. Father, we thank you for this word about the mission and what you care about. Lord, it clearly shows what you care about, and that these men and women were working together to accomplish your will through worship and fellowship and discipleship and evangelism and just their teamwork. And so, Father, we thank you for this. We ask that you would give us your grace and help us to achieve the same. In Jesus' name, amen. Am I doing something? Oh, yeah. Communion. It says it right there. Okay, so I'm sorry. So, yeah, we've changed a lot of stuff in our service, but not that. Sorry to stun everybody. Okay, as we do every week, and we'll continue to do, we will celebrate communion together. And so I think most of you know how we do that. We will come up, and you'll take the communion elements. There's two cups together. The bread is on the bottom, and the juice is on the top. So I invite you to come now, and let's partake together. So you can return to your seat, and we will partake together once you return to your seat. Our time of communion is meant to cause us just to remember through a couple of physical elements what Jesus has done for us. And so we remember the sacrifice, the substitutionary sacrifice that Jesus made for us. In Isaiah 53, written 600 or more years before Jesus even came, God gave Isaiah a vision of a Messiah or Savior that would come. And he said these words. He said, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken and smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And upon him the chastisement that brought us peace. And by his wounds we are healed." So all of us, like sheep, have gone astray. And we've turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And so we see Jesus being our sacrificial lamb. That's what he did for us on the cross. It was necessary that Jesus died for us so that we could be forgiven and come back to God. It wasn't just a nice example. It was necessary for Jesus to die. And so the Apostle Paul, when he was writing back to these Corinthians, this place that he had just left, he wrote to them later in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 11. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I have delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" So let's partake together. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's partake together. Lord Jesus, we give you thanks for your substitutionary, necessary sacrifice for us. Amen. Now I sit down.
Please stand.
Thank you.
Thank you, Isaac. All right. So, announcements. We do have our My Next Steps discipleship starting in a few minutes. Now that we wrap up, there'll be some time for fellowship. We'll do some cleaning up real quick. And today we'll be going through our initial assessment, and Pastor Dave will be leading us through that shortly. So please kind of greet one another and then sit on back down so we can start the assessment as soon as possible. Outside of that, our usual community groups, our life groups are going on. Make sure to check in with Vic. Our next one is probably next week on the 17th. For Emmy and Jeffrey, that's happening on Thursday night this week at Emmy's house, if I've got it, next Thursday. Okay, so the 17th as well. Okay, excellent. Or the 19th, I should say, actually. That's what that plays out to be. All right. And then Steve's is going over on Zoom. But that's about it for now. Thank you very much.
And now for the benediction. So if you're just visiting today with us, I invite you to stay for this next step discipleship, the assessment. It's kind of like going to the doctor and him giving a run through of all the different ways, you know, that maybe you need to exercise a little more or cut down on your salt or something like that. But so we're going to be doing this assessment, and you will find it valuable, even if you're not planning to be a regular part with us. Okay, so this is the most standard benediction in the entire Bible. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go and be blessed.
Did not send you the playlist of the James.